I had this whole video planned out, recorded, edited, ready to upload about this crazy new up-and-coming CVE that could be worse than Spectre and Meltdown, worse than Heartbleed, as bad, if not worse, than the damage that XCU chills would have caused if it shipped to stable releases. And then somebody had to go and leak the vulnerability because I don't know, Vince seems to have literally zero vetting who can be on that list. Then I just scrapped the entire video, and you know what? The vulnerability isn't even that bad. Don't get me wrong, it is a problem, and it absolutely should be fixed. But it's nowhere near the scale the author was making it out to be. All of this started with a tweet from Simone Margaritelli, the one who discovered the vulnerability. Unauthenticated RC versus all GNU Linux systems plus others disclosed 3 weeks ago. Full disclosure happening in less than 2 weeks as agreed with devs. Still no CVE assigned. There should be at least 3, possibly 4, ideally 6. Still no working fix. Canonical, Red Hat and others have confirmed the severity a 9.9, 0.1 lower than XZUtils. Devs are still arguing about whether or not some of the issues have a security impact. I've spent the last 3 weeks of my sabbatical working full-time on this research, reporting, coordination, and so on, with the sole purpose of helping, and pretty much only got patronized because the devs just can't accept their code is crap, responsible disclosure, no more. At that time, this is all we had to go on. Shortly after, though, he protected his Twitter account. When it came back, he said this. For everybody asking, I locked my profile because I've been asked to take down my tweet. And F that, because the conversation should not be whether or not I use this platform and a bit of dramatic effect to apply pressure. It worked. What a shit show. It's gonna be fun. And a few days after this, before there was any official announcement, before people acknowledged the fact that this had already been leaked, this went up on GitHub. Review locking / multi-threading implementation. According to Evil Socket, cups browsed can be held up for an extended period of time. To which he was like, this has not been disclosed. Why are you pinging me? Everybody knows what this is now. So because this was an absolute mess, there was also the Vince leak. He discussed it with the involved parties, and rather than waiting for the 6th, they went early with the disclosure, which led to his write-up, Attacking Unix Systems via Cups, Part 1. Now, there is not yet a Part 2. I don't know when Part 2 is going to be published, but this is all we have. We also have another post from Till Campeter, the leader of the Open Printing Project, Open Printing Newsflash, Cups Browse Remote Code Execution Vulnerability, which includes some very important context left out of this write-up. Now, before we get into the explanation of how this works, this is broken down into 4 separate CVEs. 2024-47176 against Cups Browsed, 2024-47076 against libcupsfilter, 2024-47175 against libppd, and 2024-47177 against cupsfilters. There is a lot of pieces that go into this, but the actual exploit is really, really dumb. Plus, a couple of other bugs that will be mentioned and that are arguably security issues, but have been pretty much ignored during the conversation with the developers and the cert. They are still there, along with several other bugs that are more or less exploitable. Now, if this was just an exploit you could do over a LAN, that would be a problem. But it's a lot worse because you can do it over the public internet. And at least theoretically, it could affect everything that uses cups. Linux, some BSDs, Chrome OS, Solaris. Apparently, there is going to be a second article at some point explaining how the macOS version is also affected. Also, WSL does have the ability to have cups installed and is potentially exploitable as well. In some cases, it's enabled by default. In others, it's not. Full disclosure, I've been scanning the entire public internet IPv4 ranges several times a day for weeks, sending the UDP packet and logging whatever connected back. And I've got back connections from hundreds of thousands of devices with peaks of 200 to 300,000 concurrent clients. Now, a couple of very important details not mentioned in this article that Till Campeter does mention here, under the section Overhyped. Attacks from the internet are not very probable due to the fact that servers on the internet do not have cups browsed and cups installed, and cups slash cups browse setups are there usually only in NAT protected local environments and desktop machines and print servers, and the remote code execution is also rather restricted as cups filters are not running as root but as the system user LP, which cannot even read the user's home directories. Also, whilst 300,000 does sound like a lot of people, and in a vacuum certainly is, when we put it in the context of how many Linux machines there are worldwide in the range of hundreds of millions, it's really a tiny drop in the bucket. Now, for the affected machines, it's a really bad drop, but most systems are not even remotely affected. Now, let's talk about the issue. So he was messing around with Ubuntu and wanted to check which services were listening on UDP ports and found this right here. The 0000 part is especially unusual. It means that whatever process is listening on port 631 is listening on and responding to any network interface, LAN, WAN, VPN, whatever you have. I also vaguely recalled that CUPS uses TCP port 631, but this is UDP. Further testing did confirm this, but CUPS browsed, this was using the UDP port instead. And considering the name, it seems like it was in some way related to CUPS, in some way related to Unix printing. And what does it do? It is responsible for discovering new printers and automatically adding them to the system. A totally normal thing to do if you have network printers. Even though it was already confirmed, checking the source code once again confirms it is listening on UDP port 631. Upon doing some additional searching, it seems like the process browse data function is reading a packet from it, performing some checks, and then doing some parsing. Essentially, this service expects a UDP packet with the format hex number, hex number, text data, and if the allowed function returns true for the specific source IP, more things happen later. Now, in the case of intended data, nothing goes wrong here. But is there a way that you can make this allowed function return true with data that shouldn't be allowed? Now, the first thing that might allow that to happen is while you could configure who can and can't connect by editing the cupsbrowse.conf configuration file, the default configuration on pretty much any system is entirely commented out and simply allows anyone. So if your system discovers a printer, it's like, you can connect. That's totally fine. Later in the code, some pointer operations are performed to parse the packet. If all checks pass, two text fields are parsed from the packet, are passed into found cups printer function. We'll return to this function in a moment, but for now, let's focus on the parsing. Now, the process of throwing random data on a project with the intention of making it do things it shouldn't do with the intention of breaking it is known as fuzzing, and cups is covered by OSS fuzz. Cups browsed is not. And when something is not covered by fuzzing, there is almost certainly going to be something that makes it do things you wouldn't expect. And also, the parsing routine looks fishy and definitely something worth fuzzing. So he went and did it himself, and would you look at that? There were things that triggered some things to happen that shouldn't have been happening. Specifically, a race condition and a denial of service caused by a stack overflow. Both these issues have been reported and thoroughly documented. I'm a bit lazy, and most importantly, I'm a noob when it comes to binary exploitation. Hell, I can barely tell whether a buffer overflow or a race condition are exploitable or not. Hardening mechanisms are getting more and more complex to bypass, and to be honest, I had no intention of spending months on this stuff. I hate printers, so for the moment, I decided to move on to what seemed to be a lower hanging fruit. So whilst there might be an exploit here as well, this is not the exploit he wants to talk about. Going back to the found cups printer function, from the two text fields parsed from the packet, one of them is a URL. After some further validation and parsing, this URL and other data are then passed as arguments to the examine discovered printer record function, which ultimately executes create remote printer entry. Thank God these are well-named functions. The create remote printer entry function will then call cf get printer attributes from lib cups filters. To understand what this means, we'll need to briefly explain what the IPP protocol is, but for now, the key points are a packet containing any URL in the form of this right here gets to UDP port 631. This triggers a sequence of events that result in cups browse connecting to that URL, a drive-by kind of thing. So I tell myself, there is no freaking way that if I send this packet to a public IP running cups, that computer will connect to the server I specified. That is exactly what it did. What he did here is connected to a server on the public internet, in this case it's one that he owned, pretending to be a printer. And it was fine with it. It also reported the exact kernel version and architecture in the user agent header. Essentially, the system now believes that we are a printer and is sending us encapsulated in HTTP a get printer attributes request in order to fetch printer attributes such as model, vendor, and several others. It makes sense. The system discovered a new printer and somehow it has to know what it is. And here is that connected printer. Now, if this was all it did, hey, sure, it's a problem. Yeah, it leaks a bit of data, but it's not that big of a deal. Where it becomes a big deal is the next part. In the debug log, he noticed it created a temporary PPD file, saving some sort of attributes to it. If we search for the PPD generation successful string in the logs, we find ourselves in the create queue function, where we can see how the attributes are passed to the PPD create PPD from IPP2 API in lib PPD. This will save some of those attacker controlled text attributes to a file with a very specific line orientated syntax without any sanitization whatsoever, because it assumes the file is coming from a printer. Now, what is a PPD file? This is a PostScript printer description. Basically, a file provided by the vendor that describes in a domain-specific language the printer capabilities to cups and instructs it on how to use it properly, looking something like this. This can be used to run a bunch of different instructions, but the important set are the cups filters. A filter is any executable contained in the user/lib/cups/filter path. Cups does check this, so you can't specify just any binary, which will get executed when a print job is sent to the printer. So what needs to happen is there needs to be an existing filter in this location that lets you run arbitrary commands. Now, you shouldn't have this, at least for modern printers. The problem is there are some really old printers designed in really, really stupid ways. So there is a thing called Fumatic Rip. And this is not the first time this filter has been a problem. CVE 2011-2964 and 2011-2697 back in 2011. The filter accepted the Fumatic Rip command line directive in the PPD that would allow any command to be executed through it. Now, this is a long fixed issue. At least it should be. When Fumatic Filters was integrated in the cup system, this fix was not ported to cups, as it is possible to verify by the PPD argument, initially removed as part of the fix and still present in the code today. And in fact, we can find mentions of the Fumatic Rip command line directive being leveraged for arbitrary command execution in the more recent 2024-35-235. According to the cups developers, it is very difficult to limit what can be provided in the Fumatic Rip command line in the PPD file. The open printing team have been talking about ways to limit what can be done through Fumatic without breaking existing drivers. We can certainly recommend that people not use Fumatic, but there are likely hundreds of older printer models before 2010 that are only supported through Fumatic, and many of those hundreds of models use this directive in creative ways. This is an actual thing used for handling printing on certain printers. TLDR, printers suck. Especially older printers, they suck more. So in theory, this is how we get our RCE. Force the target machine to connect back to our malicious IPP server, you know, the thing pretending to be a printer. Return an IPP attribute string that will inject controlled PPD directives to the temporary file. Wait for a print job to be sent to our fake printer for the PPD directives and therefore the command to be executed. This is a very important if. If you do not print to the fake printer, this will never be executed. So you have to pretend to look like a real printer. And if people are paying attention to what they're printing to, this will never be executed. So even against those 300,000 vulnerable systems, there is not a guarantee that you're going to be able to attack 300,000 systems. It is entirely possible that people don't actually print on those systems. They just have cups installed and configured in a way that you can see it. Now again, there is still the possibility of the race condition and stack overflow. Those are problems that could potentially be exploited, but binary exploitation is even harder. Now do you see why this isn't as big of a CVE as it was made out to be? Yes, it is bad, and yes, RCEs are always bad, but it requires user intervention to actively run the RCE. But if you want to be absolutely certain you won't get attacked, obviously, go and update your system because they've patched the problem. If your system does not have an update yet, you can make sure that Cups Browsed is disabled. But what do you think about the problem? Do you think it's as big of a deal as people were making it out to be? Not people, the author was making it out to be. Or do you think that because it requires human intervention, probably not as bad? Maybe part two of the blog will give me something else that is really bad, but at least for now, I think I was right in my initial estimation that this is kind of a nothing burger. What do you think? Let me know your thoughts down below. So if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, and Libero Pay linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and just don't own a printer. Just don't have cups installed.